Hello, folks, and welcome to the Vertigo Tea Party, and let's try Victor Vran. It's developed by Heimamont Games. I believe I pronounced that wrong. It's also published by Eero Video Median. You can pick it up for $19.99 on Steam or on GOG. On Steam, you can get a 2-pack or a 4-pack. The 2-pack is $34.99. The 4-pack is $59.99. It's available on Windows, Steam Play, or Mac. It supports single and multiplayer and has full controller support on Steam. It supports Steam Achievements, Steam Trading Cards, and Steam Clouds. I will be playing a press copy that was provided to me for free to cover this game. So let's hop right on in, and I'm going to try to explain hop right into the combat, and then I'll detail it a little bit more. You have a hub area here called, oddly enough, the hub, which is, your general area to talk to NPCs, follow up on quests, sell things of that nature. But I want to get right into the action immediately. This is your overworld map, so you can hop to wherever it is that you need to go. We'll cover a lot of this in just a bit. But first of all, a lot of you want to see how this game plays, so I want to hop right into the action. Now, when you join, every map has five different challenges, and you'll get a reward for each. The icon for the reward tells you what you'll get. This shows, I think it's gold. This more ornate chest, I believe, is an item, and the banner gives you experience. So we need to slay champions, we need to slay Essence of Fires with ranged attacks, we need to find four secrets, slay two demon spiders, and we need to slay Essences of Rock with melee attacks. So we need to pay attention when we're fighting and make sure we kill them with the right types of attacks. Let's go ahead and hop into the stage. I love little side challenges like that.
You are looking for your delicious little girlfriend. Oh, that's so sweet. I'll help you find the doll.
All right, so this is an action RPG. It's very similar to games like Diablo, Torchlight, Incredible Adventures of Van Helsing, I always forget the name of that one that's free to play. But it's very similar to those types of games. If you've played those, this is going to seem very similar. Now, of course, it does have its own unique aspects, which we'll be covering here. But we want to kill these fire things, the Essence of Flames, because, as I mentioned before, these will give us... Don't stand in the red. Red is dead. And as you can see, it's updating our quest because we killed those Essences of Fire with ranged attacks. This is Essence of Rock, so I'm going to switch to a melee weapon, which in this case I have a rapier. This game does not have classes at all. This is one big difference that has over other games like it. There are no classes to worry about. No mage, no caster, no tank, anything like that. Your skills and the skills you have access to are based entirely on what weapon you're using at the time. So in this case, I've got two different weapons, and you can have up to two different weapons available at any given time. Right now I have the rapier, and I can switch by pressing middle mouse button, switch over to the shotgun. Again, this game does support the controller, and you can change the controls, but I like them the way they are so far. This is an Essence of Rock. So I'm going to switch back to melee. I'm going to use my demonic power, which again, we will cover in a little bit here. And like I said, I want to show you how the combat looks, feels at first, and then we'll kind of cover into the more in-depth stuff. Like, what am I doing? I'm not just clicking buttons. That's one thing I really like about this game, by the way. You're not just clicking buttons. At least so far, I haven't been. At lower difficulties, you'll be able to obviously probably get away with that. But even that, I'm playing on normal because typically I like to play on harder difficulties. But this game pretty strongly suggested... Oh, that was awesome. This game pretty strongly suggested that I start off on normal. So I went ahead and started off on normal. And I believe you can up the difficulty at any time. Now, you'll notice these skeletons often will get back up. Skeletons will always get back up once if you don't overkill. Overkill, which you might have seen that message, happens when you do significantly more damage than the enemy has left. So for example, let's say the enemy started with 100 hit points, you got it down to one hit point left, it's just hanging on to life, and you hit it for 50 hit points, which is half of what it would have had, its max hit points. You'll get overkill. That matters on some items. Some items will give you bonuses on overkill. Skeletons, if you if you knock them down the first time with an overkill, they will not get back up. But even if you don't overkill them the second time, they stay down. So this looks like a secret chest. Yep. And we got a card. Hope. So now that you've gotten at least a very basic view of how the combat and whatnot works, let's look a little bit more in depth at this so you understand what the hell I'm doing exactly. Here's your inventory screen. Now, you don't have normal pieces of armor. You have outfits. You have a choice of three different outfits to start with. All the outfits, as far as I can tell, they determine how you grant or you gain overdrive. Overdrive is kind of like an adrenaline type resource, which when it fills up, you can use these super abilities, which are better than anything else you typically have access to. The outfit I went with, I gain overdrive every second, but I don't get any bonus for doing damage, which has actually been quite handy in some cases where I need to hang back at a tough section and just let my overdrive charge up while I wait for it. I don't have to like go in at low health or anything like that. So you have two consumables. I've chosen to have a healing potion and a leech bomb. Bombs are different in this game as the bombs emanate from you. You don't throw them, which is an interesting change. Here's our two weapon slots. Now this is where it gets kind of interesting. Again, your abilities are based entirely on the weapons that you've chosen. And I'll go back to that in just a second. This is going to be like your demon power, I believe it's called. This, you can look in here, you can look here for all your various powers. Right now I've got time bubble, and I'll keep that and I'll swap some of these out. You find these powers, these demon powers, they drop from creatures, you can buy them from merchants, things of that nature. As far as the rest of our inventory, this is all of our weapons are put here. Your various consumables here, and again, you only have two consumables on your available to you at any time. Your powers, which you just covered. Destiny cards is another interesting aspect. These are passives, which, you find these cards, you can buy them, things like that. You start off with only like two slots, and you also have a point total. So you'll notice each card has like 3 points, 4 points, one, etc. Here, you cannot have more points total than what's listed here. So if I took, I don't know if I even can go over that, because I don't have any very expensive cards. Nope, I don't have any more four cards. But let's say I had this, say this card was a four, I couldn't use it because that would put us at 11 total and I can only do 10 max. Right now I'm doing a more critical damage build because both of my main weapons give me a chance, increased chance to crit. So I crit a pretty good bit. So I'm doing like 60% extra crit damage. And also I gain 100 health on crit with a 5 second cooldown, which means if I crit, I get 100 health. But if I crit immediately after, it doesn't work. I have to wait 5 seconds for it to trigger again. But 5 seconds is pretty short. And this last thing we'll go over a little bit later, because I think that's pretty important. That should be talked about on its own. It's a pretty cool aspect of the game.
Choices. Which way to go? If you feel so inclined to take the West Road, give my regards to the Hangman, will you?
Now that's the voice. We don't know who the voice is. He just started talking to us suddenly, and he's still talking to us. Now we can dodge. I'm not doing a good job of it, but we can dodge. Now the way you dodge is you move the mouse cursor. Well, there's two different ways to dodge, actually. I can either move the mouse cursor and hit D, and I'll dodge in that direction, or I can roll the mouse down or up, and I will, based on the camera's positioning, I will roll in that manner. So I'm going to switch, because again, we want to use ranged against this guy. So let's talk about the various abilities, since this guy's going to take a little bit longer to kill. Now this is an interesting gun. This is an electric gun. Now when you shoot an enemy, it electrocutes them, which snares them, and gives them an electrocution charge. Basically, they'll stay electric. You don't want to heal up, since he's shooting me while I'm trying to talk about what I'm doing here. So that keeps him electrical charge for a few seconds. Now this ability here, ball lightning, will seek out enemies who are charged. Now this is not going to be a big deal here because we only got the one enemy charged, and of course now he's running away. He's scared of the ball lightning. But we want to keep him charged, want to keep him snared, and to pull the ball lightning. Now you can actually have three of these ball lightnings out at a time, but they do have a recharge time. But see, now we keep him nice and charged and the lightning balls just keep bouncing on him. We also have an electrical trap that you can see I just threw out there that will go out a short distance and then explode. Now the thing that's interesting about this gun is, I don't know if you noticed it, but the little electrical ball That will hurt you. That will kill. That they will hurt you. Your own little electrical balls can hurt you, so you have to be careful with that. You could also hurt allies with it, which I can see that being very interesting online. However, I find the damage overall, I'm not really crazy with it. I just got my first electrical gun. I've not really been overly impressed with this. The damage is just really bad. This definitely feels like the type of weapon you're supposed to synergize with other things. Keep in mind, again, you can keep two different, and I keep standing in the electrocution, which doesn't really help. You could also, one nice thing is with the electrical trap, if you hold the button, you can actually shoot it out faster. So if the enemy is further away, you can do that. We want to kill this one last. Well, actually, you know what? Let's switch to the from this gun. It's like, you know what? I don't like this electrical gun. Electrical gun. Let's go with this. The piercing shotgun of the Ram. This is a yellow item. This is the highest quality item that I've gotten. And by the way, if you're not familiar with this kind of action RPG styling, gray is like, theoretically, your low tier items. They don't have any special attributes, or maybe they got one special attribute. For example, this hammer has good damage, but monsters drop 47% extra gold. Man, that's all right. Then you have green is the next step up. So this one has 36% faster weapon skill cooldowns, like the electrical trap that I talked about earlier that we had to wait on. That will recharge 36% faster. And critical hits knock back enemies with a 5-second cooldown. So you notice it has two different traits. So generally, green items appear to have three different traits. Now the yellow here, it only has the two, so I'm guessing maybe it just has better, or maybe it's got a good combination of damage. I'm not really quite sure what designates this as yellow, but there we are. This one has armor penetration and inflicts daze on crit. So let's go ahead and equip that. You can also, you'll notice some items have stars. You can actually favorite items. I find this very, very useful in this game because you have the two main weapons that you can switch between, but sometimes I'm like, oh, I'm low on health. My timers are down for my health potions because you can't just chug health pots. You have to wait for a timer. In fact, let's use one now, and you can see it is 30-second cooldown, which is actually not bad at all. But now I have a regular gun, and you can see our abilities have changed. We have a regular shot, which just does damage as you would imagine. Now, one interesting thing here is that you'll notice that it's popping up. Well, first off, we went ahead and got that bonus for killing five of those guys with ranged attacks. And it drops a little banner that drops the experience, which actually I like quite a bit. Where is this thing that's shooting fireballs at me? Because it's pissing me off. I actually like that better than the game just giving you the experience. I like the fact that you get to pick up the items. I don't know, there's just something about, ooh, pick up the shiny that I really like. But anyway, and we're not going to kill the... Well, we might as well just kill this guy with this gun. One thing you'll notice is that sometimes it'll say vulnerable above their heads when I'm shooting them. It is supposed to be done by timing. You see here, I just said vulnerable. Vulnerable means they take extra damage from the next attack, I think. We're going to use a shotgun blast. It shoots a blast like a cone in front of you and also gives you extra speed. You also have aimed shots, which does extra damage and instantly recharges if you kill the enemy. Now you'll notice I did a sniper shot there, and because any enemy. So sometimes you want to use a sniper shot to finish an enemy off, or again, anytime you kill an enemy, aim shot automatically recharges. So sorry if I'm also trying to stumble explaining all this quickly, but I want to kind of cover it all while it's happening and give you an idea of what's going on here. So that's the shotgun. I actually quite like the shotgun. I also really like that there's some abilities and benefits by timing things properly. So for example, like with the shotgun, if you time the attacks correctly, it'll inflict the vulnerable condition on the target. Next attack on this target will score a crit. Now, sometimes it's hard to tell what they mean by timing it correctly. Because it means like, so basically you're not just like, you know, spamming attack. It's so that, you know, you wait and then you shoot like right at the perfect time, like right as it refreshes, I imagine. So let's try on this guy. Well, if he, and sometimes enemies die so fast it can be a little difficult to time it correctly, but you'll see it pops up sometimes. The timing is a little bit more difficult to figure out exactly what they mean. I would like some kind of like a noise perhaps, or some kind of visual indicator. A noise would be even better. This is, oh, you timed it correctly, you know, good job. that, and we got 158 on that. So again, there's a lot of synergy that can start to be being built up, by the way, based on how you're built versus your abilities. So for example, the vulnerable thing gives you your next attack is going to be a crit. Well, remember, we get 100 health on a crit. So that can be very useful. There's other things that can be, that are even better on crit. For example, enemies will blow up in like a explosion of energy. And again, you'll notice the skeleton got right back up because I did not overkill them, even though I did overkill them when I... the second round there. Let's go over the rapier abilities quickly here. And again, I do want to cover, I won't cover every single weapon, but again, I want to give you an idea of the variety of the weapons. You can see he's timing his attacks there. His the cone slowly goes down as he's getting closer to firing, which is pretty neat. But I'm going to dive at the last second. Stab him a bunch while we talk about the abilities of the rapier real fast. So here's your basic left click flurry, a chain of attacks that penetrate armor. Final attack of the chain grants the enrage buff. Enrage, your next attack on anyone will inflict 100% extra damage. Now this can be a little bit hard to pull off. One, because enemies tend to die very quickly, so you don't get the full, because see, you have to get all those attacks. That last attack with the last charge, you have to get in. So enemies are often usually dead before you get that far, or have moved away from you, things like that. So that can be quite difficult unless you're fighting like bosses or other tougher enemies with more hit points that can sustain, can actually survive through that whole hail of melee attacks. You have the charge, which is basically you just charge forward with the rapier and do a lot of damage. And we have a coup de grace. Now this is a very weird ability, in my opinion. Single target, high damage melee attack that causes bleeding. On kill, this attack resets the cooldown of the charge. So it's interesting because ideally you want to use bleed. Bleed does 2% of the total maximum hit points of the enemy, up to 100 max, but it can't kill. But the benefit of using this comes from killing. So basically, you need to kill them with the actual coup de grace strike in order to charge. It's a little weird. A lot of times what I'll do, if I can find an enemy here, is I'll charge in and coup de grace whatever's left and then charge again. So we'll charge. Oh, everything died. Oh, I'll coup de grace, reset my charge, and then I'll charge again. And then coup de grace comes up very quick. So I can zoom right into that bullet so that it hurts a lot. That works out really well. Boom, again, using coup de grace as soon as it comes up so that I can do the charge. So you really start seeing some synergy when you combine things here. Let's get coup de grace. Finish out all those enemies. We'll kill this last guy and I'll also show you a level up since we just got a level up. So that, again, that guy got up because we didn't overkill. And he would not have gotten up that time even if I didn't overkill. But let's go ahead and level. Every level, you get health, but you also get other things. Sometimes you get cards, sometimes you get more destiny points. Destiny points are your card totals that we talked about before. So we give you 300 hit points, which is always good. We can choose a card. Let's see, the moon. Cause a frost explosion on crits. And let's see, 15 second cooldown. It's kind of, long cooldown. It's only 2 points though. 10% crit damage on a rogue and the alchemist. I've actually never seen this one. Lowers the cooldown of consumables, which includes bombs and health potions by 15%. Divine, removes a negative condition on kill, 10 second cooldown. Interesting. Okay, so these are divine cards. This is the first time I've seen divine cards. Divine, 20% chance to negate a critical hit, which is pretty nice. Divine, gain 250 health when the overdrive is filled. Those are pretty nice. Let's actually go with... let's go with the moon so we can mix it up so you can see some of the more active abilities. And we'll swap that out with one of our rogues, since they're both the same anyway. You can see the more explosions that happen when you crit. Also, weapon-wise, I'm actually going to swap in the hammer so I can show you some of the synergy that you can build going between two different weapons, which is one of the reasons I really like this game so far. The combat is different from Diablo in that you don't tend to just run in and just start spamming attacks like you tend to do in Diablo. Not that there's anything wrong with that, but you don't do that as much. I'm also going to use my Time Warp ability, which again is our demon power. You can notice everything is slowed in here. I'm going to use that to the coup de grace on this guy, but these guys are a little bit beefier, as you can see. Oh, we're gonna go. I'm gonna go ahead and use the leech bomb. As you can see, the bomb went off around me instead of throwing it, and it leeched hit points from all the various enemies. All right. So now I'm trying to talk and do this. These guys are actually kind of rough. You can see our false explosion went off and hit absolutely no one, which was awesome. I used coup de grace to get rid of that guy quickly. And coup de grace, even if you're not going to kill an enemy with it, it's good to get that bleed on them because 2% of their health is pretty nice. These guys can hit pretty hard. But I want to take this ranged guy out first, though, because he's annoying. Got a vampire card. All right, we got overkill. So now we want to use overkill on that. I think that actually crit. These guys hit pretty darn hard, so you'll want to dodge them when possible. We got our over. Well, we can get overdrive for that time for some reason. And again, we got the frost over from the explosion, which again did not help us in the least in that case. So if you notice, sometimes you will get into trouble. You will actually start to getting close to death if you're not careful. Die. I always overkill after, like, I've killed them once. I don't know what's up with that. Now, another cool thing, if you look, you'll see here this little face will glow when you're close to a hidden area. Now, you can jump in this game, which I actually have not even covered until now. You can sort of jump over attacks. It's a little hit or miss sometimes, but it's there. But get rid of this guy. Get out of here. And again, overkill, so he did not come back. You can move the camera as well, but we cannot get in here. You can also wall jump. Just at least show you. I don't think that's what we need to do here. But you can move the camera. You can wall jump. Let's try. Oh, hello. Person.
Reach high, for stars lie hidden in your soul. Dream deep, for every dream precedes the goal.
Alright. But anyway, so I think he was trying to give us a hint that we need to do this jumping back and forth, and you can see that's glowing, so we're on the right track. And let's move the camera again. Oh, there's the treasure up there. Easy. You can also use WASD to move around. I'm using the mouse just because I'm an old school Diablo player. Ooh, a scythe. Vicious Scythe of the Assassin. I want to kind of look at that. I like scythe. Scythe is one of my favorite weapons. 36% faster weapon cooldowns, critical hits knock back enemies. That's all right. Very quickly, let's look at the hammer, because I want to, show you some of the synergies that I like. Pound is just a regular attack. The third attack does a lot more damage, but the hammer is obviously very slow. Let's switch to the hammer. And which can, you probably want to get a little bit more hit points if you go that route. Crush deals high damage and applies the cripple condition. You can also hold it to charge it to do more damage. And E is smash. You jump in the air and it gives you a lifesteal. But can I jump onto this guy from here? Oh, that'd have been awesome. Let's just go down the long way. Whoa, that's freaking out. But anyway, the lifesteal buff makes it so that damage you do heals you. So what you can do is, like, let's say, all right, I want to smash in here and then switch to the rapier and quickly do as much damage as we can to get more health back. Now, obviously, you can still do that with a hammer, but if you're more comfortable with another weapon, or if you've got another weapon that you think can do more damage, then you can do that. So let's go ahead and use our time slow here. Let's go ahead and get the bleed on him. We're going to dodge him, which is actually pretty easy when he's knocked out like that. We're going to knock these guys out with this. Nobody likes ranged units. Nobody. Gonna switch over to the hammer again. Do that. You can also charge this, which will give you a lot of healing. But of course, while you're charging, you can be hit, so it might be an overall loss of damage. Alright. I love that rapier charge, personally. A lot of fun. But yeah, lightning gun is probably my least favorite so far. Dodge his attack. Nope. You're not going anywhere. But yeah, you can start to see a little bit there where some of that comes in. Let's show another weapon real quick. One of my favorites, since I mentioned that. I'll just grab a scythe. Scythe is interesting. One, because it's a scythe. And of course, scythes are awesome.
Have you always been a hunter, Victor? Doesn't it get old doing the same things over and over? Slaying monsters, looting chests, saving damsels. And perhaps it is your time to try a new craft. Something exciting, like a pirate. A pirate I was meant to be. Trim the sails and roam the sea.
Right. So it's kind of funny because the game is like pretty gloom. And the narrator voice type guy is always chipper. Which you could argue kind of takes away from the overall feel of these types of games. But honestly, I think a lot of people, myself included, don't really play these types of games for the story. I play them more just to play an action RPG game. I don't really... It's one of those genres I don't really care that much about the story, right? I just want to kill things with fun abilities and level up and get gear and all that good stuff. So, yeah, it's... I mean, it's there. And what's interesting, and I was kind of hoping the main character would talk, the main protagonist would talk, but it's actually voiced by... And I forget the voice actor's name, but it's the same guy who does Garrett, or Geralt, rather, from... we're going to go ahead and slow these guys down. Probably should be using ranged against these since they shoot fire. Swing through here. Get the bleed on him. And the overdrive powers up pretty quickly, even the one I have that does over time. And especially if you're an explorer like I tend to be, like looking, I've got to find all the secrets. It gives it time to kind of charge up. So let's go and zoom in here.
You find you a bit hypocritical. You claim to be the protectors of humankind, but the truth is that all you care about is killing for loot and gold.
Guy's very judgy. So yeah, the scythe, when you attack, if you look above, like if you look right above the health bar, you'll see a scythe counter that's at 7, it's gonna go to 8, etc. You're collecting soul shards every time you attack. And your other abilities, your other scythe abilities at least, are empowered by that. So what that means is you have two different attacks with a scythe. Or special attacks, I should say. Why don't they keep attacking me while I'm trying to explain how this works? You have a stun, like that. And you have a whirlwind attack, which I can't use yet because it is on a timer. There we go. And while you're doing the whirlwind attack, and actually sometime afterwards. Let's go ahead and daze him again. And since our cooldowns are up, let's go ahead and switch weapons. See, this is what I mean. I really like that you're encouraged to like switch weapons. Like, you know, just kind of utilize the synergy between them. And sometimes it's not necessarily synergy. It's, well, I'm on cooldowns on this other weapon. I need to switch. Also, one other nice thing about the scythe is, remember before I was talking about how if you time your attacks, sometimes you get benefits. With the scythe, if you time your attacks, it lowers the cooldowns of your abilities. However, again, it doesn't really indicate that. In game, there's no indication, as far as I'm aware, that indicates that you're timing it right. You'd have to just kind of watch this, like eagle eye it to see if it would change, which obviously you're probably busy killing monsters. Now you'll notice the eyes did glow, so there's something here that rock down there is shooting at me. Now this area definitely seems like you want to have a ranged weapon, so we're actually gonna throw this pistol back in here because these guys are very much getting on my nerves. Oh, I just ran into that one. Wow. Wasn't even going to get hit by it. Come on. Ah, jeez. Sometimes there are little invisible walls. Oh, there we go. So let's shotgun him. Use that. Got him invulnerable. That frost shot was very handy there. And shotgun. Knock them away. Gonna switch to the rapier, because these guys aren't really so bad in melee. But yeah, I really like the weapon switching. I really like switching back and forth, and again, you know, in some cases, using like the weapon synergy for your benefits. Alright, and once we've done this, I want to show you the... Come on. Just die. And that's where snipe comes in useful, because since you're killing every time, you can just knock them out very, very quickly. And you don't have to deal with their fiery attacks. So on challenge-wise, you can see we found 2 of 4 secrets. There's another secret here. I'm not going to spend a lot of time trying to get that when you get the idea. We still need to kill some melees, etc. So here's our hexes. You can actually access them from the tab menu, or you can activate them from your inventory. Hexes make the game harder in specific ways, but reward you with 10% extra experience and 5% extra items. Again, challenges, I love challenges. I love little things that say, oh, do this special thing and get a reward. You know, find the secrets, or, you know, kill this boss, side mini boss that's off to the side, or do this a specific way. Or some of them are pretty rough. Like, some of them will be like, kill 80 enemies without taking damage, which obviously melee or range is really good for that. And I love that kind of stuff. I also really like being able to increase the challenge of the game while also being rewarded. Obviously, extra challenge is its own reward, blah, blah, blah. But it's also nice to get a actual reward from it. And that's where hexes come into play here. So let's go over the hexes quickly. A hex of malice. Monsters hit for 50% more damage and cause cripple for 2 seconds on crit. And all of these give the same bonuses, so there's no reason for me to read all of them off. A hex of pain. Victor Vran loses health periodically. Hex of... And obviously, again... I like also that you can kind of strategize around these hexes. So for example, this one where you're going to lose health periodically no matter what, you might want to use a hammer all the time or have it as one of your weapons. Or you might want to use your cards or gear yourself in such a way that you've got lifesteal to counteract that, so it makes it not a big deal. A hex of tenacity, monsters gain 120 armor and regeneration. Monsters move and attack faster. And hex of tyranny, some monsters become champions. Now let's go, and you can activate as many of these as you want. You can do them all at once if you want. We're not going to do that. I think that'd be a bad idea. Let's go with the one where he loses health periodically, since we do heal ourselves a little bit every 10 seconds or so. And let's say some enemies become champions. And I think we can change the difficulty too, where we won't actually do that. Gameplay. No. Maybe you have to do that in the hub. Regardless, I'm almost positive you can change the difficulty, whether it be up or down. So these guys have homing fireballs. They are very annoying.
Let's do an experiment. Come on, Victor. Follow the gold coins.
Gold coins. Oh, hey. Okay. I haven't ever seen an event like this. This is interesting. There's a champion. Could I ignore you guys until... Oh, this, that ability is a pain. Oh, that's another interesting thing that I like. So, you notice that enemy has that ability there that shoots that ball of light that follows me around. Now, enemies can actually drop those powers as cards. So, I can, when I kill this guy, I might actually get that power. I'm going to dodge that. Get that speed upgrade so I can... Nice. And of course he's going to come back. We're going to slow him down. Oh, there's another champion over there. That's going to be fun. Let's go ahead and heal up. Yeah, that fireball thing, there's not really a whole lot you can do there other than... I went ahead and used a shotgun there. The sniper, because I knew I'd kill this little buddy. Purging Flame, yes, we did in fact get it. Ooh, that, oh god, that gives me horrific nightmares of the arcane enemies. We're gonna wait. We're gonna go in here and time bubble him. Go and bleed him up. We're gonna bubble again. Alright. Like I see, that's what I like about this game so far over things like Diablo, which I mean, I obviously still love Diablo. But it's less about just going in and like, okay, you have these 3 or 4 abilities. You're just going to spam those over and over until you win. Boom, right in the back. you have to, you kind of have to plan, or especially if you up the difficulty, or, you know, have these other things going on. I knocked him out of it. Good job. See, I knock him back in? No, I obviously cannot. But you actually want to swap around your weapons. It's kind of a more... I mean, obviously you have some general strategies, right? Like, oh, use the coup de grace, or use the charge, and then coup de grace to reset the charge, and then charge again. So, I mean, there's some basic things like that, obviously, you set up. But for the most part, so far, it's been more like, again, just kind of figuring it out as I go. There's a skull over here. I'm going to guess that's a boss. It throws me off that the minimap doesn't rotate when I change position. So I want to go try this guy real quick. But yeah, we'll probably wrap up here shortly. The overdrive, one thing I forgot to mention. Oh, the Hex of Pain. I have to be careful with it. In fact, I'm going to take myself to the inventory. Well, I can't. So the overdrive, you'll notice there's like a little slash in the middle here. You can actually use your overdrive before it's totally full. At least later on. A lot of this stuff, keep in mind, you don't get from level 1. Some of it you do have to unlock as you level. Oh, here's the gold trail.
Oh, how exciting. Oh, maybe there's even more treasure at the end of the golden trail.
And I hit the wrong button.
Perhaps a big bat monster.
Alright, so I wanted to wait for that to go away. So now that I've slowed him... We're going to use that immediately because we know these guys are all going to be all bunched up. And there we go. So another thing, I guess I should show you some of these extra powers. At least go through them. Maybe swap them out, see what else we got. These, you see, there's a decent amount of variety. Diamond is basically a shield. It has a chance to reflect projectiles. Let's see, meteor. I'm not really a big fan of this one. You basically pick where the meteors come down and it does damage in an area. Boomerang is all right. Now, shockwave is pretty nice, actually. So I'm going to pick that one, and we'll swap in and try that one for a while. I'm interested to see where this gold pile goes, because I haven't seen anything like this. But enemies keep getting in the way. Let's go ahead and use that. It does good damage, and it knocks enemies back. Which, you know, sometimes you don't necessarily want, but... Oh, and we did another challenge. So we're making... Oh, we got an item. Looks like a sword. So, yeah, so far, at least, there's been about... Switch the gun. I think there's about 6 different weapon types, I think, that I've run into so far. Just die. Come on. Oh. Hope I hit the right button. There we go. Wow, it was brilliant. Oh, we got another level already. Nice. But, what is this? Oh, this is you find healing potion or healing areas. You find buff shrines, again, kind of like Diablo. Where is this guy leading us? To death, it looks like. Or at least that's what he thinks.
I think you're going to like this place.
At least get my dot on this guy.
It has treasure, even more things to slay, and a nice, colorful surprise.
Want to kill one of these with coup de grace. Looks like I must have misclicked or didn't kill it. Now these guys have a little bit more hit points. So let's step back since this guy's using his fire. Let's hit the wrong button again. Waste a grenade. Very good. High level play here, obviously. Now, the one thing I've heard that does... Whoa. Oh. Again, this is an ability I've seen. It's like Cloud of Shadow or something. Go ahead and use our abilities. Get him dotted up. Now, these guys especially, you probably want to try to overkill so they don't come back the second time. But he was pretty easy. But yeah, I gotta say, I really, really enjoy this game. The combat has been very engaging so far. I really like trying to think of different synergies, trying to make the weapons like work together, and it feels really good when you're like, oh, okay, so this enemy's got a fire AE, so I'm gonna weaken him up a little bit with aim shot and the point blank shot, and then I'm going to, you know, go in real fast and coup de grace to get the dot on him, and then use my demonic ability so he's slowed down or knocked back and finish him off. And then I'm going to switch weapons again, so when he breaks up into three, I can use a shotgun to damage all those guys. Like, I love that. I love that, like, constant adjusting to the situation that's going on that you're doing. And of course this will change. Like, you might find some other sword, like a sword, for example. Oh, this sword is so good, I can't not use it. So now you switch in the sword, and like, okay, now I have to kind of rethink about what I want to do. Do I want to change my cards around? Do I want to change the power that I'm using? I love all that. I think that's really, really cool. I've just really been enjoying this game so far, quite a lot. The negative thing that I've heard that I started to talk about was that the game is pretty short. I've heard it's like just a few hours long, which is unfortunate because the levels are not randomly generated. Let's go ahead and just hop in here. I'll kind of kill some stuff while we go. Is this one of those ones? Slight essences with the Hex of Time inactive. Which one's the Hex of Time? Okay, so you can see some challenges are restricted by which hexes you have active. Again, I love that kind of stuff. I love it forcing you to play the game a little bit different. Most of these obviously are pretty basic stuff. Slay monsters with Bombardier Spider's Barrage deck. Okay, I don't even know what that means. But, you have to kill these enemies with melee attacks or kill these with range. So you do, it forces you to play differently to get them. If you want them, you can obviously ignore them completely. But I like to do them, so I love that they're there, and I like that there's so many of them because every map has five.
This is my favorite place in Zagoravia. I call it the Cave of Warm Fuzzy.
So again, see though there, I kind of weakened him up with ranged. I switched the piercing to zoom in to like get into him quickly. He was very weak by that point, so I used coup de grace, killed him, he spawned the three enemies, and then I used charge again because it recharged with the coup de grace to damage the other. I love that. It just feels really, really good. Again, the levels are not randomly generated, to my understanding, so I think we're going to actually head back to the hub area here, but I think that's probably one thing that can hurt this game is because things aren't RNG. And because there aren't classes, I feel like the game's replayability is probably pretty darn low. I also have to wonder, like, I don't know what the top end game is like. You know, with Diablo 3, for example, you've got rifts and greater rifts that you can farm and all that kind of. And it's been a while since I played Diablo, so there's probably even more than that that I've completely forgotten. I don't know if this game has any of that, so if that kind of thing is important to you, you might want to check. Keeping in mind, the game is only $19.99. And I feel like one of the highest praises I can give a game that I do a Let's Try, because I Let's Try a lot of games. And I feel like one of the highest praises I can give a game is, like, once the Let's Try is over, I usually uninstall the game, not because I don't like it, but just because I don't have time for it. It didn't appeal to me that much after a few hours. But the biggest praise I can give, I say for the third time, is I want to keep playing the game. I still want to play this game. I want to play it to the end, because like I said, I find the combat very engaging. I like all the options you have. You would think without having classes and without having skills, it would really feel like, oh man, you just keep using the same abilities over and over. I haven't found that to be true at all. I mean, maybe there's some perfect combo of two different weapons that you can, that are like overpowered if you just keep swapping back and forth, but I haven't found that, and I don't really care if I did, because then I just wouldn't do that. I just find it's fun to figure that stuff out myself, switching out the demonic power card, switching weapons, coming up with new strategies, having things pop up on the fly. I really like that, and I actually want to keep playing this game because of that. But anyway, I kind of wanted to talk to some NPCs, so I wanted to give you a little bit of the kind of the story and hear some of the voice acting, and for those of you who are interested in that kind of
Forget
thing.
Forget about Irene. She was doomed the moment she set foot in this wretched land. Her beautiful body is now no more than worm food. I warned her, and I'm warning you. Do not venture into the dark. Now, how can I help you in this foolish endeavor?
He's very, very upbeat. We got another level. I'm not going to bother leveling. Actually, you know what? Oh yeah, transmutation. This is a small thing that obviously I haven't unlocked yet, because you have to be level 16. But you can get these treasure chests sometimes when you complete a quest. You can pick like a card or something else, or you can get a gift box. Gift box will give you a random treasure, and I'll just show you that real quick. There we go. And we got an item, Inquisitor Sword of something. But you can also transmute multiple boxes into a better treasure box. Unfortunately, it doesn't unlock until level 16, which is unfortunate. I don't know why that doesn't unlock for so much later. We're already, what, like level, 13. But I think that, I don't really see the point of making that such a high level. But anyway, I've really enjoyed this game a lot so far. I could see like a little bit more variation. If you're big time into like the item hunt part of the game where you're finding different armor, that probably is going to disappoint you. I've never found a different outfit. I'm sure there's ones out there, but I've never found one. Also, visually, there's no change because all your visuals other than weapons is based on your outfit. You're going to look the same most of the time. At least that's been my experience so far. All of the item collecty type stuff in this game isn't armor and, you know, boots and weapon and, you know, things like that. Again, more akin to Diablo. It's these weapons here. You know, obviously, you know, if you're just really, really like the rapier, you know, finding better rapiers. But again, say, oh man, this sword's so good, I'm not really crazy about the moveset, but it's too good to pass up, then I could see, you know, you have to kind of adjust for that. But yeah, the potions, not so much. Powers, obviously, finding new upgraded powers. So like, even if I've got a shockwave, later on I might find a better one. Maybe it's got a bigger radius. Maybe it lasts longer. Things of that nature. I realize that's not a time warp. But anyway, cards is another big one. Another big way that you'll upgrade. And you can see you got these divine cards that have like normal abilities, but also divine on top of that, which gives you some extra oomph, which is cool. And again, the hexes are there to... You don't find new hexes. As soon as you hit like level 10 or 12, that's when the hexes are just available. You don't find them. They're there, and you can turn them on or off, which is pretty neat. But yeah, overall, I like this game a lot. I definitely wasn't... I like action RPGs, but I wasn't expecting to like it this much. My only concern is, you know, a lot of people like games like Diablo because there is so much replayability. Going through the campaigns is different character or different classes. You know, there's like, what, 8 different difficulties in Diablo, something insane like that. This game's got like maybe 3 different difficulties, I think. You have the hexes, which that you customize the difficulty, but it's not quite the same thing, even though, again, I like their take on it. So I wonder about the replayability. I feel like it's a game that once you beat it, you're probably going to be pretty much done. You're probably not going to play through it again like immediately after. Maybe pick it up like a year later or something like that. But it's not a game you're just going to keep playing. For some of you, it might not be a big deal. But those of you used to playing games like Diablo, where you get to the top and then you work on Paragon levels and getting better and better and better gear, I don't know if this game has it, and I don't get the impression that it does. Again, you might want to double check that if that's important to you. Again, keeping in mind the game's like $20. So let's quickly, last thing, go over some of the odds and end here as we wrap up. And by the way, and I know a lot of people don't want to listen to the extra stuff here, I do have links to the game both to GOG and Steam below in the description of the video. So go ahead and if you want to pick this game up or check what other users are saying, you can click on those. But see, maps and challenges, it'll tell you the various maps that you've unlocked thus far. Codex is pretty cool. This is standard stuff. It tells you about what the different weapons abilities are, monsters that you found, that, you know, gets pictures of them all, which is, again, I like, an extra nice touch for those of you wanting to learn more about the world. Your different conditions that you can inflict or be inflicted by, like, you know, haste, enraged, slowed, you know, things like that. And there's a lot of those too, by the way. Recipes, I haven't found those. I don't know what that is yet. I haven't got far enough into it. We can also check out the cutscenes. In fact, let's listen to the Geralt's voice actor.
The survivors are gathered around the war table. There's tension in the air. There's also fear. There are not enough guards to hold the castle. Irene has been missing for a while now, and they think that I have left them for good. The Queen still insists on continuing the fight. She asks them to do the impossible. What they need now is a sliver of hope. I've changed my mind. I'll stay.
At last, you see. We will overcome the invasion.
This is not an invasion. I now know what is happening here. The city is a trap. A trap for hunters.
And what would you do?
Spring the trap.
So, speaking of the story, is kind of meh so far. Again, I don't really play these games for the story. The voice acting's been pretty hit or miss. Honestly, a lot of miss. The Geralt's voice actor is great. But I might be biased because whenever I hear that voice, I can't not hear Geralt. I mean, let's be honest. From The Witcher, if you're not familiar. I have not played the online stuff at all. I'm not really that interested in it. I could see maybe playing with some friends, but not really the type of person who would play in random online things. But it's there. Again, if you're interested in that kind of thing, you might want to read other people whose experience, what their experiences are. Again, I've never really tried it myself. But yeah, that is Victor Vran. Yeah, I like this game a lot. I actually want to keep playing it because I really do enjoy the combat. I just find it very, very engaging and very rewarding. I like the challenges that they have presented in the game. I like the hexes, so you can kind of customize your challenge, and maybe if you're having trouble in a section, you can turn some hexes off until you get past it and then turn them back on. I think it's a polished package, right? A lot of times you run into cases where these smaller games, there's what I've started calling indie jank, where the interface doesn't seem quite right, the graphics don't quite match up, the font is a little off. You know, just these little things that makes it feel like a little. But this game, I really don't feel like has that. Obviously, yeah, there's the things like when you talk to NPCs, there's just the static images and whatnot, but yeah, I don't really have a problem with that. And there is a stash in the game too, by the way. It's kept by someone named Private Stash. His rank is Private and his name is Stash. Yes, well done, game devs. I thought that was pretty amusing when I saw that. But anyway, that's enough rambling on about Victor Vran. Again, I really like this game. My only warnings, if you like action RPGs like Diablo, Torchlight, Incredible Adventures of Van Helsing, Path of Exile, that's the one I always forget. If you like those types of games, absolutely check this game out. Again, especially just for $20. My only concern and my only warning would be those of you who want a lot to do at endgame. I don't know if that's there. I get the feeling it's not. But again, double check that before you make a decision either way. Anyway, thank you guys for watching. As always, make sure to leave comments in the comment section below. Let me know what you're thinking of this video and of this game. Also, follow me on Twitter, and I'll see you next time.